This is Ben Jones. It is Absolute Radio, and the script are here in our little camper van of love. Good to see you.
How are you doing? Actually, I was passing this little van earlier on. I thought it'd be great for a little jamming session.
You know what? It looks very, very nice. Feel free to do a little jamming session.
It's a bit like the Mystery Mobile, isn't it, in Scooby-Doo?
Yeah, I'm not really me. I'm like old man Carruthers, the evil librarian.
Zip yourself down.
We got to the bottom of it.
So here we go. You're about to play live this afternoon, and we're looking forward to it. I think you're going to get one of the most amazing reactions of the day.
Well,
a lot of people are very keen to see you because you've had an amazing year, haven't you?
It's been absolutely crazy for us. We say this a lot, but it really, you can't dream dreams like this. You know, we released a record thinking that we would hopefully get played in local radio in Ireland, and it just took over. It's everywhere now, number one in Australia.
You're getting played on radio everywhere?
Everywhere. It's crazy.
Do you still get a buzz when you hear your songs on the radio?
Yeah, absolutely. It's something we're really proud of, because I think whenever you take a photograph of us, we run. You know, but the minute the music comes on the radio, we go, quick, turn it up. You know, it's something we spent a long time on.
When you hear your stuff, though, are you happy with it? Or is it stuff that you would actually, given the time, you'd go back and maybe retweak a few songs?
I think every piece of art that any artist creates is never finished. I think it was Leonardo DiCaprio I was going to say, but I meant Leonardo da Vinci.
Mr.
DiCaprio, yeah. There's another lick of paint to go on there. But, you know, Da Vinci said that, you know, when is the next lick of paint enough? You know, that's what deadlines are for. They really are. You have to walk away from your art sometimes.
Did you come to a lot of these sort of festivals prior to you doing the band, prior to you being in a band?
Yeah, well, Dan had been to quite a few. There's a huge one in Ireland that used to be called Fail It. And Dan and Dan's brothers used to play there a lot. So he had the unique opportunity to tour around and kind of go down there and be backstage and do all that kind of cool stuff. But the rest of us just got muddy. You know.
There's a lot of bands, a lot of artists who'll be maybe watching this video or listening to this interview on the radio who want to be in the position that you're in. Mm-hmm. And not that long ago, you were in their position. So yes. How on earth do you go from that to doing this and being on the radio and doing the festivals?
I think our policy was just to make the best record we could and not just stop with your friends and family telling you the music is great. For us, it was really getting online and be really active and really finding from people what was good. And we kind of A&R'd our music through that sort of process. We wrote a bunch of songs and narrowed all those songs down to probably 10 songs that we were extremely happy with. But we always say the only time success comes before touring is in the dictionary, you know? You have to get out there in front of people. You just have to.
This is day three for me. I'm a little tired.
I'm sorry.
Do you know what? If you'd actually said to me, "Hi Ben," I'd have been looking around to see what Ben is. Oh yeah, that's me. Right. Okay. Cool. So talk to us about writing new stuff. Obviously, we're on single number 5 from
this
album.
Unbelievable.
The phrase "flogging a dead horse" is not right here, but I mean, single number 5. We kind of released everything from this album.
Yeah, I think there's like 10 songs on it. We're gonna release the next 5 as well. You know.
Are you thinking about new songs yet? And have you had a chance to start even contemplating writing new songs?
Yeah, I mean, as creative people, as soon as, you know, we were talking earlier on, as soon as the first album is finished, the creative process for the next album has already begun. Mm. Even though we're not, say, let's say, in the studio every day writing and creating, you know, we're almost like, you know, little tanks that as soon as you're living life and the tank gets fuller and fuller and fuller, and now it's literally to the
for us, for every territory like America that's now starting to break in America, Australia and stuff, you go, where are we going to find the time to get into a studio and actually lay this stuff down?
2 years' crazy. Time, you'll still be singing this album, just like in Japan
we'll
or Mexico.
We should be on
our
10th single.
But we'll be on to album number 3 back home.
Yeah,
but you'll be singing the original songs.
Yeah.
So are you nervous about getting out onto stage today? Because this is a pretty big festival now.
I'm always, well, I mean, as a band, we always say to not be nervous means you don't care, you know, and we get nervous all the time. Yeah. We really do. We go up there just, it's some different orders. We played Crow Park last night, which was 80,000 people. And
wow.
To be honest.
Okay. All right. So this is nothing then.
No,
really.
But this is what I'm saying. To be honest, that is just unrealistic at the end of the day. Put me in front of 10 people and I'm more nervous than anything.
Well, that was the thing I was going to say, playing the small shows where you can see the whites of people's eyes, where you can see actually that maybe these people don't like that song, so they nip off to the loo or get a beer. That's probably more nerve wracking, seeing people clear off. Whereas when you've got a massive field of people.
Exactly.
It's almost like looking at a poster. You know, I had a poster of a crowd as a kid on my wall, and that's all doing the big shows. It just looks like that. But I also have another trick where, because like yourself, my eyesight's quite bad, so I pop my contacts out if it's an intimidating crowd. I pop my contacts out so I can't actually see them.
Yeah, you do the whole gig and then you realise you've had your back to the crowd for the entire time.
He's waving at me. Love, no, he's not.
I've been singing Manic Heavy Move to a guy the whole time.
Who in the band has the final say on whether a song makes the grade or makes the next album?
You know, it's generally we're all on the same page on it, you know.
I think it's when we play it live is usually the
crowd normally do. It's not even someone in the
really
band.
Next.
The crowd.
Because you can't. An audience never lies in that sense. You know, the one thing is we always try new songs here or there in the show, and we come off going, "Oh my God, that died a death because they didn't respond to it," or and it's all those kind of things. So you kind of judge your music that way. Put it on stage, and you're gonna know.
These festivals are predominantly regarded as being sort of rock festivals, and yet the lineup this year, there's a fine line between sort of rock and pop. What are you? A rock band, are you a pop band?
Well, I think we're kind of both. You know, I think what's great about the festivals nowadays is that they're completely reflecting the generation we're growing up in, you know, like the iTunes generation. You know, you'll find that, you know, in anybody's iPod, they're going to have great songs in different genres. They're going to have a great song in rock, great song in pop, great song in all across the board. And I think it's about time, you know.
The genre doors now are all being knocked down in a way because... Like, again, like you said, you'd probably see 50 Cent walking in the street with a bulletproof vest on, his big medallion, listening to his iPod, and he's probably listening to the sound of music. You know?
Girls allowed.
Yeah, but you know what I'm saying? Because you don't know what people listen to nowadays. Everybody has their guilty pleasures, and now we're finding that through people's playlists.
Do you find that some people are musical snobs? I'm one of those people. I have a very eclectic taste in music. You know, I love working on this radio station, where I can play anything from sort of Phil Collins to the Foo Fighters.
Yeah.
And I find that some people are a little bit dismissive of maybe Simple Minds a little later today. I'm like... You know what? When they
band.
Do Don't You Forget About Me, there's not going to be a person in the crowd who's not singing along.
And you know, this is the thing. The thing is that, you know, I think the internet is moving so fast and it is creating such a big demand on the public. Want more and more and more and more. The appetite is absolutely huge that we tend to forget about the classic artists that we're passing by all the time. And the artists that are coming up, that where are we going to find the Bowies anymore? Are we going to find those the Bob Marleys anymore? Are we really going to find those guys that were true artists and give them the chance to find themselves? I'm not so sure because the appetite is so big right now. But I think, like you say, there is people like yourself out there who are true now. They're finding they're getting hating all the new music that's
coming out. I draw the line on Michael Bolton.
Yeah,
we
all do. I celebrate his whole catalogue.
For me, it doesn't get any better when he sings.
Steel Bars, Raptor. I'm actually slightly nervous that I even know the words to Steel Bars. Listen, it's great to see you. From what I hear, we're just literally a few copies away from a million.
Yes,
a million
we're
copies.
Almost there, we're almost
so
there.
I 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. There's about 10 people
if you
here.
If you guys could all run out, you get a copy. Yeah, I think we're good.
Any plans to celebrate when we hit that big one?
I think we're going to have
1 million copies.
You know, unfortunately, they have us busy so much. I say they, as in the man.
The suits.
The suits.
Yeah, you
have
will
us,
work.
Yeah.
We're going to be on a plane, I think, when that happens. That's where we're going to be.
But you'll be in first class because you'd have sold a million albums.
Well, no, we'd probably ask for first class then.
That's what Listen,
maybe that'll be the celebration.
Great to see you. Thank you for coming and joining us in our little caravan. It doesn't go anywhere. It stays here.
It's fantastic.
Someone has to tow it along. But we so look forward to seeing you.
Thank you very much.
On the main stage a little later. And come in and see us again at Golden Square.
We will indeed, absolutely.
It's the script, everybody.
Thank you.